I want to learn yoga to attain kind of a mental calm, practice mindful meditation as well as yoga. I wanted to explore some Eastern ideologies as well, and my kind of contention is that, you know, if there's something stronger in Judaism, then I'll come to realize that on my own.
What you're looking for has to be found within yourself.
Yeah.
And you're Jewish?
Yeah.
So you have to find it as a Jew. Mm-hmm. Even the books in the Far East teach you, you should find your spiritual path with you, which you were born to.
Sure.
And since you're born a Jew, you should find it as a Jew. But since you have your mindset on going to the Far East, let me give you a couple things to look out for.
Sure.
Because they have things over there that seem very nice. Like you're looking for mindfulness, relaxation, openness.
How much time did you spend there?
Years.
Years.
Okay. For instance, one of their goals over there is called moksha. Now, moksha means freedom. Kind of what you're looking for, total freedom. Total
detachment
relaxation.
From the ego.
Not just ego, but to be free from all the pulls of life, detachment, totally free. And once you start tasting into that, you may get into the point where you think that's the purpose of life, to detach from the world. The Torah says, no, the purpose of life is to attach properly. To attach properly.
Today, over a billion men and women identify themselves as Buddhists. From its beginnings in India 2,500 years ago, the message of the Buddha was initially only transmitted by a few wandering monks. Three centuries later, in Bactria, it would undergo a profound metamorphosis through its contact with Greek culture. What was the spiritual, artistic, and cultural alchemy that gave birth to such an immensely popular religion? Buddha, the Blessed One, was convinced that man searches for idols. Therefore, he expressly forbade any representation of his person. Thus, primary importance was placed on the spiritual message alone, to oppose man's natural inclination towards idolatry. The Indian artisans told the story of the Buddha without ever representing him other than in the form of a lotus, a horse without a rider, or a tree. This was a way of honoring the instructions of the Buddha Sakyamuni to never represent his image. This would only be respected until the 2nd century BC. Bactria, a kingdom founded by the successors of Alexander the Great. For almost a century, the descendants of the soldiers Alexander left behind during his conquests had colonized the kingdom. In addition to the descendants of Alexander's soldiers, the local populations that Buddhist missionaries discovered also included Greek settlers coming from Greece, Egypt, and Antioch. In other words, a world deeply marked by Greek culture. This was the first meeting between Buddhism and Greek thinking, and it would be a fundamental one. A flourishing type of art started in this region. It owed its existence to the artists and artisans originating from the Mediterranean, who adapted their skills to local tastes. It is revealed in the architecture, the statues, and paintings, and is called Greco-Bactrian art. Bactria, the Greek colony furthest away from the Mediterranean, was governed by kings and a local aristocracy. In common with Alexander the Great, the Greco-Bactrian kings were characterized by their open-mindedness and their respect for the beliefs of other populations. The most well-known sovereign was Menander, who ruled Bactria in the 2nd century BC. When the Buddhist monks arrived in Bactria, Menander decided to question one of them, called Nagasena, an old Buddhist sage. How do the teachings of Buddha resolve the problem of suffering? How can you attain enlightenment and overcome death? Over 300 of these exchanges between the two men on the meaning of life and death were compiled, enabling the sage to express the spiritual message of Buddhism. These dialogues were translated into Chinese and for several centuries would serve as fundamental texts for teaching Buddhism. This face-to-face encounter constitutes the first meeting between Buddhism and Greek philosophy. Ten Buddhist temples were built on this site. Hada suddenly became famous when no less than 15,000 Buddhist sculptures were exhumed, revealing that Gandhara was the holy land of Buddhism. Unfortunately, the sculptures can now only be seen in photos, as most of them, in common with the giant Buddhas at Bamiyan, have been destroyed, the victims of the religious vandalism of the Taliban. These statues were the first representations of the Buddha and date from around 100 BC. They embodied the Greco-Buddhist school, which appeared in the region where Hellenism was solidly entrenched. The innovation consisted in daring to physically represent the Buddha, which the Indian tradition had only evoked through symbols. Professor Tarzi was responsible for discovering this sculptured piece, composed of a Buddhist character enthroned amidst Greek gods and heroes. What immediately attracts the attention is the way the statue of Buddha has been represented. His tunic is Greek, with typically Ionian pleats. This sculpture, representing a goddess offering fruit, is a typical subject of Hellenistic sculptures. She is next to an athletic character reminiscent of Hercules, a Greek demigod. On another sculptured piece, Professor Tarzi noted a male face. The purity and sureness of the features, and the similarity to the profile in other depictions of Alexander, suggest that this could indeed be the famous conqueror. The encounter between a Hellenized Buddha and the characters of the Greek pantheon marks the birth of a new kind of art. In fact, the historic meeting between Buddhism and Hellenism responded to a demand from the newly converted population to see their gods represented. Therefore, for the first time, the Buddha appeared with the features of a young Apollo.
Hi, I'm Sam Zadora, and I'm inviting you to a very special masterclass. The subject is going to be Tantra, intimacy, and sacred sexuality. Now, for some of you, that might be a little bit out of your comfort zone.
Look at me being all edgy with a hood. I'm a very edgy Buddhist, a very dangerous Buddhist. The other thing you have to understand with the Buddhist worldview of reincarnation and philosophy is that today we tend to look at the Buddhism from the point of view of philosophy and not from the point of the worldview and reincarnation. However, Buddhism, as it existed for the vast majority of Buddhists throughout its history, existed the other way around, from reincarnation up. That is to say, most average people, most average Buddhists, what they did day to day is actually orient themselves to have a better rebirth. That was their number one preoccupation. So they would give offerings, they would commit positive deeds to have good imprints, they would seek blessings from lamas, etc. All of their action, they would avoid killing. All of their actions were really directed toward that goal, toward obtaining a better rebirth. The lay Buddhism that you see around you today, that you associate with, like meditation, philosophy, all those things, really the majority of lay people, the vast majority of lay people in traditional Buddhist countries, didn't engage in any of it. This is just the advent, the manifestation of Buddhism that came about when mass education happened and people could now more directly relate to these ideas of emptiness and to all of those things. For most of Buddhist history, that just wasn't the case. So Buddhism from the outside, Buddhism for the majority of lay people, was definitely a religion, structured in much of the same way as Christianity or any other religion, except with many rebirths. For many people, Buddha was, if not the creator god, like some sort of a pagan polytheist deity that you needed to appease in order to receive his blessings for wealth, for health, and for a better rebirth. And the teachers, the lamas, were magical semi-wizards who could grant blessings as well. Now, this is a crude simplification, and I risk being elitist. Compassion was also very important in lay Buddhism, so I don't really want to caricature it, because there were different people who lived difficult lives, and I don't want to really shit on them. But realistically speaking, at least take away the fact that this was the reality, and it's actually the reality today with many Westerners. This is what they seek: a magical lama, a guru, a savior guru. People really love different initiations and stuff like that. A lot of people are really into it, so it's not just, you know, Tibet at the beginning of the 20th century. I mean, that kind of still defines. I mean, this sort of philosophy and analyzing and deconstructing reality, that's not what everybody exactly is interested in. And so there was a huge contrast between a learned monastic and the average person in terms of their actual religion. And the monastic regarded average people with a fair degree of patronization, let's say.
One of my younger brother, who recently visited Australia, when he returned from Australia through Singapore, one Chinese lady, looks to see rich sort of lady, rich family, and she mentioned she is Buddhist. Then my brother is politely asked, what's Buddhism? Then she mentioned in front of Buddha some incense there.
No incense.
Some incense. That is Buddhism, she mentioned. Then another occasion, one Buddhist, I asked, what is Buddhism? Then his answer is, repeat that, recite that, that's Buddhism. No. These are clearly shows lack of knowledge about Buddha Dharma. Unless we study years, just simply traditional way, not Buddhism, meant for wealth, meant for health, it's not Buddhism. Isn't it? Like that. So therefore, I think education or study of Buddhism is very essential. Now I'm over 76 years old, but still I consider myself as a Buddhist student. Still I read, study, and contemplate as much as possible.
An interesting contrast between folk Buddhism and the more monastic Buddhism would be someone like Green Tara. Now, you might be familiar with people who have sought Green Tara and asked her for help and were actually relieved to deliverance. They actually did receive the blessings of Green Tara. You might know YouTubers like that. You might be aware of them.
Another quality of feminine principle which Tara embodies is playfulness. Tara is frequently depicted as a young 16-year-old girlish woman. She often manifests in the lives of Dharma practitioners when they take themselves or the spiritual path too seriously. There are Tibetan tales in which she laughs at self-righteousness or plays pranks on those who lack reverence for the feminine. This is my relationship with Tara. You see, at the time I was on a downward slide. I was unraveling. I wanted to have a compassionate presence in my life who would urge me on. And in my mind, I started communicating with Tara. Now, be relieved that I didn't actually hear voices, but I thought that there were thoughts generating, coming from Tara into my head, communications. And the only thing that could obstruct them would be my attachments or my own thoughts, projecting my own desires and needs onto this pure communications. And so I would try very hard with the recitation of the mantra, with focus, etc., to purify actual thoughts of Tara. But I literally felt her almost like stroking my head and my face because I was so lonely and needed that encouragement. And literally in this room right now where I'm filming, I would do full body prostrations continuously, day in and day out, to them. And as I was doing them, I could almost, in the same way that I almost felt that presence of the goddess of nature, who might have been Tara in a different emanation in college, in a similar way, I almost could feel their presence in the room. Even though, again, I never saw anything that wasn't there or explicitly heard them.
The story of Green Tara is actually almost a feminist one. She was a princess a long time ago, before this universe began. And at this point, she developed bodhicitta, the mind of enlightenment. And some local Buddhists at the time, under a different Buddha, have advised her to pray to be reborn as a man, so that she can obtain enlightenment in a superior vessel, in the male body. And she called out these clowns by reminding them of emptiness of inherent existence, and said only weak-minded people see some fundamental difference between male and female, because gender is empty, empty of inherent existence. And at this point, she pledged to be reborn in a female body up until enlightenment. Tara is presented as the mother of all Buddhas, and people routinely ask her for help. Monks and lay people reach out to Green Tara for help. However, on the more ultimate level, Tara is the mother of all Buddhas not because she actually gave birth to them, but because she herself is an embodiment of transcendent wisdom. She herself is an embodiment of emptiness, and therefore ultimately an embodiment of our own mind, empty of inherent existence, that is endowed with Buddha nature. So you see, Tara goes all the way from like a theistic deity to Buddhist philosophy. It's a beautiful circle, but that doesn't mean that Tara never existed as that princess or as a bodhisattva. It's just her ultimate nature is, of course, not in any way theistic in nature. Of course, when many people do pray to Tara, the mother of all Buddhas, the idea of emptiness is probably not on their mind. Emptiness, the realization of emptiness, gave birth to Buddhahood each time it happened. But the mother of all Buddhas is a more sweet and comforting feeling that aids you through a very difficult and often short life. Literally everyone, all the statues, all the different representations and quote-unquote characters you would see in a Tibetan shrine room are actually representations of the same thing, the enlightened mind. They're all Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, and therefore they ultimately have the same essence. But out of great compassion, they have manifested in different forms, because on our search and approach to enlightenment, we need to have different forms to relate to. We can't always 100% of the time just relate to Buddha Shakyamuni, but we shouldn't get distracted by their different genders and a more fierce and wrathful appearance or a more benign and compassionate appearance. Those are all just the same thing, ultimately. But we have to, we actually don't have to, but through our inclinations, we have a predisposition toward different manifestations of enlightenment. Enlightenment is beyond concept and need not be represented in the exact same way.
On the 20th of February, 2012, the 17th Gyalwan Karmapa presided over and performed the Mahakala Lama dance in Bodh Gaya, the most sacred Buddhist site. The 16-year-old Jamgon Rinpoche is the first dancer. His red silk costume represents the speech of Mahakala, which pervades all phenomena. Mahakala Bernachen, Mahakali Sri Devi, and Vajrasadu. The three imposing figures suddenly appear before the audience. The Gyalwan Karmapa leads the sixth dance, the dance of the female gatekeeper, a 40-minute dance choreographed by the 14th Karmapa, Tekchok Dorje. It has been 14 years since His Holiness last performed this dance when he was at Tsurpu Monastery in Tibet. All those who are able to witness the Gyalwan Karmapa's dance are blessed with positive conditions and extremely fortunate.
Actually, Tara is a great example of it. Here she is emerging out of a pretty patriarchal culture, Tibet, like any other culture at the beginning of the 20th century, pretty male-oriented religion as far as the hierarchies are concerned. And yet now she emerges from it with a proud feminist banner. And yet you ladies, on a relative level, of course, this feminist ideas can direct you now. But sooner or later, you have to let that go. You really have to let that go. Because everything is beyond concept at the end of the day. Hala. Hala, if you hear... It really doesn't matter what I say now. Hardly anybody is watching this at this point. But we also shouldn't forget that these bodhisattvas and other beings grant us very specific blessings when we appeal to them. You might know of my own story when, an open, tender heart, I have cried out to Green Tara for help and have, in fact, received it in very concrete ways. In, in very concrete ways. In fact, you don't even need to be a Buddhist, according to the scriptures, to appeal to Green Tara. She will help you regardless. However, if you are a Buddhist, and especially if you have received the Green Tara initiation from a teacher, then you'll have a more direct karmic connection. But Green Tara will try to help you, so try to remember the mantra Om Tari Tu Tari Tori Swaha.
Om Tari Tu Tari Tori Swaha. Om Tari Tu Tari Tori Swaha. Om Tari Tu Tari Tori Swaha.
My own initiation into Buddhism was directly connected with an interference and the help of a Dharma protector, Mahakala. Dharma protectors are sworn to protect the Dharma and helping the disciples and the students of the Dharma to continue to have good conditions in order to practice the teachings. And so I was initiated into Buddhism. I was given my refuge vows and my Dharma name, Jamyang Palden, which translates roughly, I think, to something like the soft voice of wisdom. I have received this initiation from His Holiness Jigdo Dakchen Sakya. And when the People's Liberation Army invaded Tibet and he was fleeing to India, without any sense of orientation, he would do a divination to Mahakala, who is often represented by crows. And after doing this divination, a crow would appear in the sky and guide them, and then they would just follow the crow and did in fact make it out safely without any issues out of Tibet. Now, navigating out of Tibet into India with no experience and, you know, under these circumstances is very perilous, but the interference of Mahakala has allowed them to make it to safety and eventually giving me the refuge vows in Seattle.
When we were in Lhasa, from Sakya, had to go to His Holiness Dalai Lama doing doctorate degree.
Yeah.
So all the Tibetans, all the Buddhist leaders had to go special celebration. So we are visiting Lhasa because of that.
Right.
And so
did you see His Holiness receive his degree?
Yes, we
were. Oh, yeah.
And he went to those things. Uh-huh. And so when we were in Lhasa, and then they started, so we, His Holiness in the Nubulinga,
yes,
and left, so we went to move to one of the Sakya monastery near Lhasa. So we never thought we were going to leave a country. We never thought that. We still, yes, we leave some of our treasure things in Lhasa. When we left in Lhasa, we had breakfast. We left the cups just like that, and pretending that, you know, that we're just going to visit. So, and then from Nalanda, there's no way. Every road is blocked. And then there's no way we can get Sakya. Every road is blocked. Uh-huh. Every road. So then it came through the Bhutan. We ended up in India.
Then we call it the final road.
And it is guide of us, our Trupa Jim and then protect us. And only way that we got here. He's because when we started at Nalanda, and we don't know which direction, we just started, which road we take, which way the Chinese is, but there's two ravens comes always from us and flies from, and we just followed wherever ravens went. So this next day, we don't know which road we go, and the ravens comes.
And,
we just followed the raven. Every morning we prayed for the Mahakala and protector, and the ravens, when they reached the Bhutan, Duk Tsamba, and the ravens gone.
You had guides with wings.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Very
heavenly guides.
That's right.
Who is your protector again?
Mahakala is a psychic protector. It's a generally Tibetan Buddhist protector.
Yeah.
It is a wrathful protector of the genus Avalokiteshvara.
Wonderful. The wrathful protector. And the ravens led you to safety.
Right.
Ravens is one of their ratno.
Ah, how interesting.
So it's on. Yeah. It is really interesting because sometimes we morning have breakfast, we can't stay here, have to go. Way we go to south, northward, which road? And then Dachirambachi do dice and, you know, that, what do you call it?
Divination.
Mm-hmm. And my uncle, old Lama, he's very good with divination. Sometimes they don't agree. Oh no, what? And then you see the raven, just follow.
The raven. Just follow the raven.
Yeah, he knew what to do.
Well, my friends, once again, I have started to film pretty late. It's 4:30 in the morning right now, and I really wanted to start it like earlier, like 1 a.m., but once again, I've procrastinated. There's one last thing I want to say about the Buddhist worldview versus its philosophy, and that is that the Buddhist worldview is actually able to accommodate a lot of native folk beliefs. When it does, a lot of academicians and others say that this isn't real Buddhism. However, if it fits the overall scheme of reincarnation, it very much is Buddhism. So here I'd like to point out the unique Tibetan tradition of the state oracle. It's, I think, the last functioning oracle that exists in the world. And this is the Nechung oracle. So back, I think it was like in the 8th century... there was a tantric master who came to Tibet to bring the Buddhist teachings. However, the local spirits, the spirits of the land, were of course committed to the local shamanistic religion Bon, and they had to be subdued before Dharma could be introduced. And so, as a tantric master, he started to use his powers, Padmasambhava did, to really bring them to heal. Some of these spirits were bound by the Dharma. They effectively converted to Buddhism and swore an oath to not harm sentient beings. Other spirits were more resistant and really were causing a lot of problems. And as they were accumulating a lot of negative karma with their attitude and their negative actions, they were then liberated by Padmasambhava out of their existence. You know, motivated purely by compassion. it's something you can do as a tantric master, is really guide beings to the next realm.
It begins with a mysterious figure with magical powers who traveled to Tibet from India. Even his true name is unknown, and through the centuries he has only been known by the title Padmasambhava, the Lotus-born.
Padmasambhava was born in the northwest corner of Pakistan in the present-day Swat Valley, or perhaps in Afghanistan. Wherever he came from, he ended up in India and became a superstar in terms of his mystical powers.
750 AD. In Europe, the Vikings were raiding the English coast, and Charlemagne was in the process of uniting the warlike tribes of the continent. In Asia, the Buddha had been dead for 12 centuries. His religion had spread from Afghanistan to Japan. And in the remote Himalayan plateau, Padmasambhava arrived, bearing the message of Buddhism. His first task was to defeat the evil demons that plagued Tibet by challenging them to magical combat.
He didn't just destroy the demons, he converted them, let's say, forcefully to Buddhism. And all of those indigenous spirits, all those indigenous demons then had a role and continue to have a role in Tibetan religion as protectors of Buddhism.
In addition to quelling and converting demons, Padmasambhava performed miracles, healed the sick, prophesied the future, and even taught some of his followers to fly. Padmasambhava's greatest challenge, however, was to defeat death itself. The book's message was so powerful, its guidance so important, that the Buddhist saint decided it was actually dangerous.
He felt that the Tibetans were not ready for that teaching, and they might have misunderstood it in some way. And perhaps it would have been misused by necromantic priests or something in some sort of strange cults.
There's a whole elaborate mythology of Padmasambhava's hiding of these teachings, of these texts, providing a prophecy of who would be the one to discover them at a future date. Padmasambhava in these stories is said to have hidden the texts in very strange places, very remote, in the middle of rocks and stones and boulders.
Padmasambhava died around 800. His accomplishments were remarkable. He had converted the entire nation of Tibet from a military empire into the most spiritual society on earth.
Guru Rinpoche is a very unique phenomenon. I have to say, Guru Rinpoche has a very special appeal to even traditionally not a Buddhist countries. It's quite an amazing thing. European, American, many, those who may not necessarily have a lot of information on Buddhism, somehow, many of them do have attraction to Guru Rinpoche. I don't know. There are all kinds of reasons for this, I'm sure. Such as, you know, like the Shakyamuni Buddha, who actually is the sort of the ultimate boss of the Buddha Dharma. appears to be very serene and kind of very pure and monkish, and so kind of very wild-natured Croatians, English, German. I don't know, somehow they seem to be more attracted to Guru Rinpoche, who sort of hangs around with like eight women, rides tiger, doesn't really say no to alcohol. So I guess, you know, even on this level, there's some sort of appeal of Guru Rinpoche to even those who are totally, you know, who has really nothing much to do with Buddhism. But anyway, so who is this Guru Rinpoche? Who was he? From the external point of view, he was a Pakistani. Do you know that? He was a Pakistani. He was born in Swat. And description actually fits quite well. And even, I mean, this is really not a nice thing for me to think that way, but when you see these Talibans with their turban and with this broad shoulder, they're so handsome, and the beard, and they're just, sort of macho and just such an elegant, you know what I'm talking about? You know, the way they move, someone who really doesn't give a damn about things. You know, someone who kind of does things like in a little bit more than the norm. And you can say, you know, those Taliban fits the sort of the image, don't you think? So, in a way, yes, Guru Rinpoche is a Taliban. I'm sure. When we talk about Guru Rinpoche, then there are some fantastical, sort of very, very, like, over-the-top stuff that you will hear. For instance, like, he was born from the lotus, right? And that's like, what? And I'm telling you, there's many, even among the, you know, the Tibetan Buddhism, there are a lot of, you know, like, especially new translations. They actually really criticize these things, like saying that this is a complete joke, you know, this is like a disgrace to Buddhism, you know, like, you know, this is, first of all, Buddhism is very, very proud of being really, not theistic, and so on and so forth. And here we are talking about someone who is born in the lotus. And someone who never died. Now that is just scientifically not acceptable, isn't it? So who is this? And then also when you read the life of the Guru Rinpoche, it sounds like he has lived for 900 years or so on and so forth. It doesn't really connect. But I want to talk more about this lotus born business, because I'm sure many of your friends, your intellectual friends, have looked on you as, what's wrong with you, you know, like you follow this guy who is born from a lotus. But this is very profound. Remember, I was talking about something that you're learning, something that cannot be taught. See, what we are trying to teach is something that cannot be taught. The only way to teach something that cannot be taught is by making this kind of completely, like, beyond our normal way of thinking, like 4 + 4 = 8. You have to go beyond that. And it is also very poetic, actually. It's very poetic. The lotus represents in the ancient Indian culture, lotus is very important symbolism. Lotus symbolizes Well, to begin with, I mean, if you talk about analogy, lotus is beautiful. It's so, you know, nice to look at, and it's pristine, and it's so beautiful. But it's born in the mud. Yet, it's not stained by the mud, so on and so forth, right? So, lotus actually here represents your devotion, your mind. The nature, absolute nature of your mind is, even though you roam around yourself in the stained, defiled world, you roam around in the bar, you may be fighting Chang Jiji, you may be, you know, overdosing here and there, you may be, you know, like, I don't know, you may be stealing, you may be lying, you may be, you know, with all of that, absolute nature of your mind is as pure as lotus. And it's believed that when we say Guru Rinpoche is born in from the lotus, the moment you have the devotion towards the Guru, that devotion is the blossoming of the lotus. And there, the Guru Rinpoche is there. It's not like, you know, sort of slow motion, the first the lotus is born, and then the slowly the petal comes out, and then, you know, like Guru Rinpoche sort of materializes. It's not like that. You understand? So it's, you know, you have to think. It's a very, very profound.
However, one of the beings that Guru Rinpoche Padmasambhava has subdued is Pihar, a very powerful spirit. And this spirit is still with us today, having a different lifespan than that of human beings. It has developed a relationship later on with the Giluk school to which the Dalai Lama belongs, and became the oracle. The way that this works is that there is a monk, the abbot of the Nichung monastery, who goes into a type of a trance where his mind leaves his body, and then the spirit of Nichung enters it. And then he goes into a kind of a trance and conveys messages. So the Nichung oracle has predicted the year when a lot of troubles would come to Tibet, the dark times. And this was the year when the Dalai Lama had to leave Tibet. Now at that point, the nobles and everybody has gathered to ask the Nichung oracle as to what should be done. And he was at first pretty indecisive, and then one noble said, when times are hard, even the gods lie, or something like that, or even the gods are indecisive. I apologize, I don't have the text in front of me. At which point the Nichung oracle actually gave, according to many accounts, a detailed map of escape for the Dalai Lama that his party then successfully followed to leave Tibet. So this is a kind of an integration between the folk beliefs merging with Buddhism on account of reincarnation. Once you open up that door into, once you acknowledge the mind-body dualism, then the mind could exist in a variety of different forms. It could dwell in the mountains and then convert to Buddhism and then serve the Dalai Lama.
The Nei Chung, as the principal state oracle, goes first into trance. He's followed by the Gedong, the oracle who does not yet speak. The Dalai Lama believes it may be because of his physical condition. He contracted tuberculosis when he came to India from Tibet. But once he disappears into trance, whatever possesses him makes a mighty effort to get out a few words. Finally, the Tenma is brought in. While she's not a state oracle, she is a protector of the Buddha Dharma, the vast body of Buddhist thought she's been oath-bound to support for the last 1,200 years. Looking at this face, it dawns on me that whether we try to interpret this experience from a Western psychological perspective, as some dissociated or transpersonal state of human consciousness, or see it like the Tibetans as a window onto a consciousness that is completely non-human, that ultimately we are witnessing the self disappearing within an experience of such depth and subtlety that any explanation for it will necessarily come up short. Although it's perhaps worth noting that the Tibetan explanation engenders respect for the experience, while mainstream psychological science treats it at best as anomalous and at worst as abnormal.
What did you learn?
No particular sort of points to ask them. This year, we will contract with Chinese government, so this should be successful. And then me personally visit different country, so any some serious obstacle there or not, they all say, okay, no problem. Then one occasion, the Nei Chung oracle much sort of moved. He asked me, I should live long. So like human being, very much emotion, nearly sort of crying. And then Tama, similar sort of response at the end, some poems expressing again for my long life, a prayer or some kind of request, like that.
Whatever oracles are, for the Dalai Lama they are not special. They are just another input into his decision-making process.
We are human beings. These are oracles. We are more important, we have more responsibility. I usually ask them their suggestion. If something according to our common sense, oh, this is definite, only one choice, then we take decision. But if there are few choice, we feel dilemma, then ask different views, different views from different people as well as different oracle.
Right.
That usually I do. So there are some sort of mysterious things there. So from the Buddhist viewpoint, not mysterious. This also is a reality, a different level. Some reality or perception, so our sort of sensorial can experience. So our sort of mental sort of concept, many concepts, mainly come through sensorial experience. So certain phenomena, the sensorial level, which you cannot touch. So only we can investigate through some indications. One of my friend, very close friend, one Indian, once asked me one question. As far as he knows, the Dalai Lama, thinking, way of thinking is very, very scientific. But at the same time, you also accept state oracle. So he found big contradiction. That I told, Oh, there are different level of phenomena. So these states, these oracles, these things are another level of reality. We cannot see, we cannot hear, we cannot touch this sort of, because of the grosser level of sensorial. But we can feel, we can experiment, we can test. So I told him like that. So then seems he understand. So I not dismissed from scientist, scientific minded. So like that.
Bihar, however, is not the only spirit of note as far as influencing politics. There is another powerful spirit that originated in Tibet that plays an important part today in the spiritual lives and political views of a great number of Westerners. And here, of course, I'm talking about Dorje Shugden. Now, the specific origins of Dorje Shugden are murky and unknown. During the reign of the fifth Dalai Lama, there was a group of people who seemed to be organizing around another reincarnated Lama in the Gelug school, which the fifth Dalai Lama headed. And this group of people were more fundamentalists, and many of them disliked the fact that the Dalai Lama received some teachings and some tantric initiations from a different sect, the Nyingma. And many of them seem to have been suggesting that actually their Rinpoche, that their reincarnated Lama around whom they were aggregating, was actually the real Dalai Lama, that he was the actual child who should have been recognized as the Dalai Lama, as he was one of the contenders for the position as a child. You might be familiar with the white scarves that are given to different people during religious ceremonies and other occasions in Tibet as a sign of honor. Well, in this case, with this other Lama, they actually found one of these scarves stuffed into his mouth. So he was no longer alive. So this doesn't mean that the fifth Dalai Lama did it. There were many parties, including Mongol warlords, who were invested in him being the Dalai Lama. But this is what happened, and the next reincarnation of that Lama was immediately banned. Now at this point, mysterious things started to happen. People were getting sick and dying, seemingly. Different barn animals were being killed, and people have noticed the presence of this spirit.
Time to float.
So this is one story, potential origin of Dorje Shugden. However, it's not clear that where exactly he originated. But if he did originate there, there was from the very start a certain, to put it lightly, tension with the lineage of the Dalai Lamas. Later on, this spirit seems to have reemerged, Dorje Shugden, and was beginning to be the subject of devotion in the Gelug school to which the Dalai Lama belonged and to which that Lama belonged.
Your Holiness, I feel agitated to see and hear the Shugden protesters outside. How do I help myself? And also please address this issue, as many are misinformed.
That can't help. Actually, this is a problem. Now last, I think 370 years. So still, that problem remains. During fifth Dalai Lama, this problem started.
The idea seems to be that this spirit is the guardian of the teachings of the Gelugpa school, of the Gelug school. And so if a person who is devoted to the spirit receives teachings from a rival school, especially from the Nyingma, this spirit is actually going to come down and kick their ass. It's going to kill them.
I knew it was you, Fredo. You broke my heart. You broke my heart.
So the current Dalai Lama, the 14th Dalai Lama, has proclaimed the spirit to be spirit worship that is corrupting Tibetan Buddhism. However, its adherents, the adherents of this spirit, believe that the spirit is actually a Dharma protector. That is to say, it's not just a worldly spirit, but is actually an enlightened being. To the opponents of this spirit, this is a worldly spirit that is pretending to be enlightened for power.
On the 7th of January, the Dalai Lama delivered a speech that brooked no opposition in this Tibetan university in South India. In front of hundreds of monks, he condemned the Shugden movement and its practitioners.
I did not put aside the Shugdens for my personal interest. I have meditated and considered this at length in my soul and my spirit, before coming to the conclusion that this is the right decision. People have killed, lied, fought each other, and started fires in the name of this deity. These monks must be expelled from all monasteries without any hesitation. If they are not happy, you can tell them that the Dalai Lama himself asked that this be done, and it's very urgent.
Why is this ban in force?
Tibetan Buddhism, such a profound tradition, but that due to this is a way of this is a practitioner of this spirit, such practice. You see, this there is danger of degenerate Tibetan Buddhism into a spirit worshipper.
For centuries, Dorje Shugden has been revered by the greatest and most important Buddhist masters, many of whom are the most renowned masters of Tibetan history. One of them was a Dalai Lama's teacher. If the Dalai Lama thinks that all great masters were mistaken, he denies them their qualification as well. They would not be great masters. All the great masters who have worshipped this deity for the past 300 years, were they all wrong?
They are wrong. Wrong? Yes? Wrong.
That is all His Holiness says about the old masters.
So ever since the current Dalai Lama has effectively discouraged the practice of this spirit in the Tibetan monasteries, the Western adherents, the Western fans of this spirit who belong to the New Kadampa organization, which is effectively a split off from mainstream Tibetan Buddhism that became a cult, they used to protest the Dalai Lama wherever he went in the West, saying, stop lying, Dalai Lama. When I first started Buddhism, the first center I went into actually was this New Kadampa tradition, and I saw a huge statue of the spirit right there next to the Buddha. Once I read up on this group, I got the hell out of there. But this is something real. Their protests stopped when it was revealed that they were receiving money from China. China is a big propagator of the spirit, and it forces all the Gelug monasteries in China to have a statue of the spirit, because it then divides them from the Dalai Lama. So yes, the struggle is real.
For example, if one great Tibetan Lama would send Dorje Shugden into the light, and he has gone, he doesn't exist anymore. Even if we have pictures of him, tankas of him, we have statues of him, we have tzatzas of him, we have drawings of him, we're praying to a dead spirit, a dead god. So nobody should be afraid of a dead god, right? Nobody should be afraid of dead spirit. So why doesn't one Tibetan Lama do that? And if the Tibetan Lamas cannot send Dorje Shugden into the light, why don't they Google and find a psychic in Europe or America or in Asia and hire the psychic to send Dorje Shugden into the light? Then guess what? We don't need to be afraid of him anymore.
Beep, beep, Richie.
Right, my friends, so at this point we're going to be moving on to Tantra, which is in a sense the highest and the most difficult to practice part of the teachings, the most advanced. And here I want to pause and say something I should have said earlier. In no way am I an expert at any of this. I'm giving you what I believe is a decent outline of Tibetan Buddhism, but of course in many cases I was just unprecise or purposefully didn't go into the details. In other cases, I didn't know the details. This video's title is The Horrible Introduction to Tibetan Buddhism. And of all of these introductions, the one that I'm completely unqualified to give is one about Tantra. Because I've never studied it in any depth and I've never really practiced it. Nevertheless, since it is an important and a unique part of Tibetan Buddhism, I have to cover it, and I will cover it. I will cover Tantra, but the warning has been given.
The subject is going to be Tantra, intimacy, and sacred sexuality. Now, for some of you, that might be a little bit out of your comfort zone.
To understand Tantra, we have to look at the three vehicles of Tibetan Buddhism. A vehicle is a combination of a motivation for enlightenment and a collection of philosophies and tools to get there. So the foundational vehicle is the vehicle where the Buddha introduced the idea of samsara and nirvana, of suffering. Basically, it is the vehicle of the Four Noble Truths, the monastic code, and the tools for personal liberation, for an individual motivation for enlightenment. So this is the foundational vehicle. The foundational vehicle is something that Tibetans share with Orthodox Buddhism. Effectively, the difference between the Theravadan school and the foundational vehicle in Tibetan Buddhism is that one is in Pali and the other one is in Sanskrit. It's basically the Sanskrit version of Theravadan Buddhism. Now, there might be differences, but those differences are not fundamental in nature. They would be detail-oriented differences. The basic laws governing the monastics in Tibetan Buddhism and Theravadan Buddhism are going to be essentially the same in nature. Then comes Mahayana. So Mahayana is that which is not recognized by Orthodox Buddhism. These are the Sanskrit sutras, sutras about emptiness, sutras about bodhisattvas. Bodhisattvas are those beings who dedicate themselves to obtaining the Great Awakening for the sake of countless sentient beings as vast as space. The motivation for enlightenment shifts from personal liberation in the foundational vehicle to the liberation out of compassion for all beings in the Mahayana. And the advanced beings who represent this are bodhisattvas. So it is also called the bodhisattvayana. The motivation shifts, the philosophy shifts to emptiness, and the methods are now also have shifted, or at least there are new methods available. So the important thing to understand about Mahayana versus the foundational vehicle is that in no fundamental way does Mahayana cancel out the foundational vehicle. It doesn't do that. It introduces a new motivation, and then if you practice tools from the foundational vehicle for the sake of all sentient beings, you're practicing Mahayana, and you can't get rid of most of those teachings in the foundational vehicle because they are in fact foundations for Mahayana practice. So effectively, the first vehicle introduces the outline of Buddhist philosophy, the fundamental outline, as well as the fundamental diagnosis of the problem and where our attention needs to be directed, which is our awareness, and of course selflessness, the idea that there is no inherent self that we possess, that it is that our awareness, our mind, should be the reference point for progress. And then in the Mahayana, we have an elevated sense of motivation and the combination of compassion and wisdom that will lead us toward enlightenment. By wisdom, it is referring to a lived understanding of emptiness, a lived realization of emptiness, and the philosophical build-up to that, and the compassion, which is the method for opening up the wisdom. The two wings of a bird is how they're traditionally presented. Like, a bird cannot fly, and you cannot achieve enlightenment without wisdom and compassion. So this is actually a unique idea that I haven't seen reflected too much in the Western world. The idea of compassion is actually something that is clarifying to your awareness, not just something that is nice to execute, not just something that makes you a decent human being, but something that in combination with wisdom actually opens up your reality, is actually an enlightening quality, a fundamental quality that is needed to understand reality. That is something to really reflect upon whether you are a religious Buddhist or not. Because while I'm not in any way a great practitioner, anytime I start to practice compassion, and practicing compassion fundamentally in Buddhism is sincerely wishing people happiness. Not in a static way, as in I abstractly wish people happiness, but actually in a sincere motivation throughout the day and through specific practices. If you begin to actually do that, then you will experience, at least I did, a great sense of relief and a profound sense of ease in the world, because you're no longer relating to people and reality through a sense of self when you do it. I mean, of course, you're always relating to reality and people through a sense of self, but even if it's relaxed a little bit, I would say the effects are pretty profound, because compassion sounds so banal to many people that its actual applied effects are unknown to these people. They're unknown, even though they're so fucking awesome. So you should try it. Now, of course, it's not all abstract. Ultimately, when you do have an opportunity to actually help people, you do it, realistically speaking. It's about having like an open heart with which you regard the world in a healthy sense without the melodrama of the self. So yes, I do strongly recommend you guys to try compassion if anybody's watching this at all.
You are talking in your book about changing the world from the inside out. How can we change ourselves? How does changing ourselves change the world?
Change the world,
I think that before we do anything or demonstrate or have any expression with our body or our speech, we first have to be ready in our minds. And so if in our minds we are joyful and peaceful, then that will show in the way we use our bodies and our minds. And so I think it is important that we do this. Like if we are trying to help other people, then the first thing we have to change is our own minds. In order to change the world, we have to change our own mind first. And so for that reason, it's important for us to think about our motivation. And if we have a good motivation, then whatever we do with our bodies and speech will reflect that. And it will change the way that we lead our lives. And it will help everyone to whom we are, it'll change everything to which we are connected. And so I think in this way, it will help to change the world as well.
Thank you.
How can you change the faults in yourself?
We have to remember that we're always changing. From every second, we're changing. We're changing from moment to moment. It's like when the watch goes tick tick tick, as it goes tick tock, we also are changing in every second. And so what this means is that every moment, we might have a problem in the first moment, but in the next moment, we have an opportunity to be a new person who doesn't have that fault. We have that choice that we can actually be a new person in every moment. And so in this way, from every moment and in every hour, we have that opportunity to become a new person. And there's no need to keep hanging around with all of our faults.
Thank you. Is it possible to care for everybody or love everybody?
I think it is possible for us to love and like everyone, but for us it's a little difficult. And it's difficult because normally we think about our friends and the people who are close to us, and we think about them as being people that we like. And then there are the people whom we don't really like, or the people who aren't our friends, and we don't care so much about them. And so in that way, that's thinking about it as if it's like our individual thing, whom we're individually connected to. But if we think about our own, and if that's thinking about it in terms of our own individual relationships. But if we look at how things actually are, it's different. So the way things actually are and then our own individual relationships are a little bit different from each other. And in the way things actually are, whether someone is our enemy or whether someone is our friend, they're all the same in wanting to be happy. And they're all the same in not wanting to be unhappy. And so for that reason, we need to look at how things actually are. And if we do look at how things actually are, then since everyone is the same in wanting to be happy and not wanting to be unhappy, I think that then we can have come to respect and care for one another.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I've been traveling in many different cities. And some of these cities are really like a film set of Ridley Scott. Here, New Zealand reminds me there's still a planet called Earth, which is so precious. I hope this will remain for a long, long, long time. We want to be awakened. We have a problem. Now we need a solution. And many times, the solutions, they themselves end up becoming a problem. Oh, there's so many. Among the Buddhists, they have also things like mindfulness. That mindfulness that is going on these days a lot, that can become a problem. Mindfulness without the wisdom is like a really, like the perfect cause for constipation. All you do is worry about not being mindful. You understand? So as we go on looking at all these paths, myriad, so many different kinds of tools and methods, compassion is most risk-free, closest to the what we talk about, the truth. Chandrakirti, the scholar I was quoting earlier, he wrote a very famous book called Madhyamika Avatara. There's one shloka, one verses, where he explained the compassion, and I'm going to be based on that. He talked about three compassion: the highest, the best, and then lesser one, and the least. The divisions of these three compassions are made based on the object of compassion, and this is very interesting. The least, the lowest hierarchy, the lowest class of compassion, uses sentient beings like human beings, ghosts, animals, whatever, sentient beings as an object of compassion. That's the lowest class compassion. So can you see now why I was going on about Trump hater, liberals, and so on? I'll come back to that. That's the least, that's the lowest. The second, the higher than that, is called that compassion uses phenomena as an object of compassion. Now that is quite high. That is actually, that is quite high. Now the third compassion is no object. So the first two has object. The first one being the sentient beings as the object, the second as the phenomena as an object, and the third one has no object. And as I'm repeating here, this third one is utmost important. Without that, you could say the character of the compassion that is taught in Buddhism is lost. Most of the time these days, when we talk about compassion, we are always talking about the first one, intentionally or unintentionally. We are always talking about that. The first compassion is what we call common compassion. That kind of compassion is taught in many different religions, and even non-religious people have that kind of compassion to a certain extent, not fully though. The second and the third is exclusive. Especially the third one is Mahayana exclusive compassion. This is important that we know. But, okay, let's talk a little bit about the objectless compassion. The third compassion exists completely only with a fully enlightened being, such as the Buddha. Even the 10th Bhumi Bodhisattvas, they only have the incomplete third compassion. Okay, now, when we talk about a compassion, inevitably we are always talking about a suffering, pain. Again, the word suffering is not doing the justice. The word dukkha or dunghal, the Tibetan word dunghal or the Sanskrit word dukkha. What is suffering? See, as we are talking about compassion, we have to talk about the suffering because that's sort of the generalized idea that you have compassion to someone who is suffering, isn't it? Again, we talk about three categories of suffering. So when we talk about the fundamental suffering, what is the nature of the suffering? Fundamentally, it is dualism. As long as there is a subject, object, right, wrong, black, white, dualistic phenomena is fundamentally a suffering. Duality. Duality is a fundamental violence. It's a fundamentally a suffering. Duality is uncertainty also. Duality, the moment there is a duality, there is inevitable uncertainty. Uncertainty is like the core, sort of the cause of anxiety. I'm addressing this to liberal Buddhist, leftist Buddhist, those who are always talking about Buddhist compassion. And when they talk about a Buddhist compassion, you can hear that lopsidedness. You can hear that, you know, sort of, you know, I was watching CNN recently, and there was this program with, they were interviewing some of those who supported Trump. And suddenly it struck me, all those people who really hate Trump, I realized they are these people who reads books like Haruki Murakami, those who meditates, those who do yoga, those who have a little bit of spare money to go to Goa or Buddhist teachings like this, those who are, I don't know, open to, what do you call it, alternative methods, so on and so forth. There's all these other people who don't have that kind of privilege and that kind of phenomena, that kind of setting. And it's, you know, when we talk about the third compassion, the object, I mean, forget the third compassion, even the first one, even the lowest class of Buddhist compassion must include in its object of compassion Donald Trump, Kim Jong-il, everyone. This is why earlier I said, didn't I, when we talk about the Buddhist compassion, even when we talk about this lowest class compassion, Even though that compassion is more common compassion to other religion and non-religious sort of empathy and sympathy and so on and so forth, most of the people do not include Bill Gates or Donald Trump as the object of the first compassion. If you are a follower of the this particular path of Buddha, of course, in the second and the third compassion, you have to, of course, object. In, even for the first one, you have to include all of them, all of them, all sentient beings.
There is a seminal story that really captures Mahayana practice very well, the ideals of the Mahayana. There was a yogi in ancient India who was meditating for years and years in a cave, looking for enlightenment. He would meditate for 3 years, come out, and everything would be the same. There would be no progress whatsoever. Finally, after 9 years of meditation, he comes out of his cave, feels nothing, no progress whatsoever, is about to completely give up his quest, when he sees a dog, a dying dog, laying by the side of the cave. So this dog has an open wound and is covered with maggots. These maggots are so attached to the dog that if you were to rip them away, they would rip away part of the dog's flesh. So this yogi uses his tongue to transfer the maggots to his tongue to then carefully place them elsewhere, because of course he can't kill them. And after he's done with this task, he realizes that this dog is a Buddha. He finally came to enlightenment through this act of compassion, through this spirit of compassion. And then he takes this dog and puts it around his shoulders, much as I did earlier with the goat, and goes to the market to show people the Buddha. But nobody is able to see it. They just see a weird dog and a strange man. Except for one old lady who sees a little bit of the Buddha and begins to prostrate in front of him. So this is the story of how the practice was very dry and pointless without that true spark of compassion. This, my friends, is the essence of the Mahayana path.
It was a little bit out of tune, but I played it anyway. But the melody?
Oh, yeah, that's it, Anna.
So now comes the real edgy part. Now, my friends, you just heard me refer to this first vehicle. The first path is the foundational path. Now, foundational path isn't actually what it's traditionally called in the classification of Tibetan Buddhism. In fact, the traditional path is more of a politically correct term that is being used today. In all the traditional scriptures, in all the traditional texts, it is referred to as Hinayana, which is the lower path, relative to the high path of the Mahayana. So effectively, the Orthodox Buddhism is dismissed as such. Now, today, in most of the Buddhist countries that I'm aware of, these two schools actually don't coexist, except for maybe in Vietnam. However, they did coexist in ancient India before Buddhism was erased there through a variety of factors. And when they did wage this intellectual warfare, or the warfare for legitimacy. And yes, those foundational teachings, if pursued, would lead you to enlightenment as an arahat, not a Buddha, from the Mahayana point of view, and actually from the Theravadan point of view as well. They don't believe that you can achieve full Buddhahood, you can just become an arahat. The Mahayana idea is this, behind calling this path Hinayana. The idea is that Buddha outlined our existence as samsara, a cyclic existence of suffering. And he outlined the path to enlightenment. So therefore, it is sort of ridiculous to dedicate yourself to personal liberation only and completely forget about everybody else who's suffering.
So with refuge, there are two main ways, which are the Hinayana way and the Mahayana way. The Hinayana, which means lesser vehicle, is where one recognizes the four common foundations, which we'll get to later on, that there is suffering and so on. And so they practice to be free from suffering and attain personal liberation. The Mahayana starts out the same. We first recognize the suffering of samsara, but then we remember that it's not all about me, but that all the sentient beings in samsara suffer just as much and even more than us. And just like us, they all want happiness. And they have the same right as we do. So how can we escape samsara alone and leave them to suffer? So that's why we practice and meditate to free all sentient beings from samsara, for all of them, including ourselves, and to attain full, perfect enlightenment. And here we're all Mahayana practitioners, at least we try to be. But being Hinayana doesn't mean we're totally selfish. It's just that they focus more on their own liberation, whereas the Mahayana aspires for a greater goal. Thus we say the greater vehicle. And we must remember that it's all the Buddha's teachings anyway, even though our motivations are quite different.
I often use mentioning, selfish is part of our mind. Selfish is necessary, taking care of yourself. Unless that kind of feeling there, you cannot extend taking care of others. So first, you should take care of yourself. So that kind of selfish is good. But then selfish, narrow-minded, blind selfish, you see, usually you should lead harming other. Just think of yourself. So that kind of selfish I usually call foolish selfish. In order to gain long-term benefit to oneself and taking care about other, that is wise selfish. It's much better. Animal cannot do. We have intelligence, so we can.
That is to say, the Buddha himself was motivated by great compassion. If he himself was practicing this path, what would be the reason, from the point of view of personal liberation, to teach the Dharma to others? He could have just quietly obtained his enlightenment, and that would be the end of the story. However, since he did teach the path, the Dharma, he must have taught it out of the compassion for all sentient beings, for all living beings who could benefit from the Dharma. And it would be odd if this motivation, from the Mahayana point of view at least, would emerge suddenly only after enlightenment. That would be most peculiar. So therefore, Buddha, as he was moving toward enlightenment through many lives, as both schools acknowledge, that motivation of compassion must have been there. It cannot just simply materialize at the moment of enlightenment. It seems like your motivation for enlightenment should be higher than just showing up to a party, realizing there are no young honeys there, and getting the fuck out of there as soon as you can. Seemingly, enlightenment, your quest for enlightenment, shouldn't parallel that sentiment of just getting out of there as quickly as you possibly can, because no young honey is there, right? So if you're not following the metaphor, right, the party would be your life, and the absence of honeys would be the absence of an ability to really gain satisfaction. Only, you know, at this sausage fest of a party, you will only experience suffering. So the motivation for leaving, you should also tell the bros to leave as well. Maybe show them to a... Fuck it, I really overkilled this dumb metaphor. But I mean, I think you get the idea. Along the way of practicing the Mahayana path, you will develop compassion for the sake of all beings, and therefore progress not as a lonely, isolated arahat to be, but as a bodhisattva who will teach and liberate beings to higher realizations along the path to enlightenment, and who actually, by having a pure motivation of compassion, will achieve Buddhahood, full Buddhahood, because that was the true motivation of the Buddha. And you will also get there faster. You will actually get there faster than pursuing individual liberation, which, according to Mahayana, will also work. If you just pursue individual liberation, you will in fact become an arahat. You will leave the cycle of samsara, but in a different category from the Buddha.
Those jewels aren't from the dwarf's diamond mine, are they?
I don't think so.
Downgrading the path of individual liberation, however, was not the only thing up the sleeve of the Mahayanists when it came to going after their rivals for the claim of being the true ultimate Buddhists. The other one is something called skillful means. You see, skillful means is something that's really unfamiliar in the world of Abrahamic religions, and it also might redefine your idea of who the Buddha actually was or what it meant to teach as an enlightened being. In the Mahayana powerhouse monastic universities, there was an idea that if Buddha's words contradict each other, or if Buddha's words contradict logic, then logic triumphs over Buddha's own words in Mahayana universities, monastic universities. So this sounds like such a progressive and great idea for religion, to actually allow to annul the views of the founder of your religions if they're found to be irrational. However, the reasoning behind this approach is actually a bit more subversive. That many times that Buddha spoke, he actually wasn't telling the truth. Or to say it more nicely, he was calculating for the aptitude of his listeners and giving them something that could direct them toward the correct path, even if what he was saying in and of itself was not the essence of the truth. It's kind of like if your nephew asks, "Where's dad?" you're not going to tell him that his dad is probably listening to shitty country music and doing meth with a bunch of lowlifes. You just wouldn't say that. And in the same manner, as Buddha was introducing his teachings to different disciples, he had to adjust for their mental capacity, for their mental aptitude.
Among the Buddha's own follower, he taught sort of different philosophical views. It appears contradictory, but that Buddha deliberately taught because that sort of particular philosophical view is suitable to that particular person. So different, because of this different mental disposition, and also from the Buddhist viewpoint, also is it due to previous karmic, previous sort of imprints. So there are so many different mental dispositions. Even you see, twins, different mental disposition, always there. You can't sort of explain thoroughly from physical particles. So like that, therefore, because of different mental disposition, Buddha taught different contradictory philosophy. As a Buddhist, what we learn from that sort of situation? Yes, on this planet, about 7 billion human beings there, and different location, different climate, different way of life, different style of food. So, different sort of culture, different sort of mentality there. So, we really need different way of approach, you see, to cultivate love, compassion, forgiveness, these things. So once we realize, recognize this factor, then we develop mutual respect, mutual admiration, like that.
You know, Buddha taught a lot of different things. Buddha taught so many teachings, and you need to know this. Some of the teachings that he taught, he did not really mean it. Do you know that? He did not really mean it. And, you know, bluntly speaking, he was sort of lying. Really. I know the Buddhists would not like to hear this, but that's how it is. Bluntly speaking. But if you want to put it more poetically, Changden, they call it. Changden means what? Expedient teaching, right? Expedient. He did not really mean it. And there are other teachings, he really meant it. Now, if you were to ask me, what is it? What are the teachings that he did not really mean it? Anything that has to do with, like, this is samsara, this is nirvana. It's all. He did not really mean it. It's this radical, really. Where he talks about, this is good, this is not good, don't do this, do this. All this expedient teaching. He did not really mean it. The next question is, oh, well, if he did not really mean it, why he has to go through all that? Oh, out of compassion. This is what the Buddha said, and the Buddhists always say, Buddha never taught because he wanted to exhibit what he knew. Never. The first, actually, right after he achieved enlightenment under the Bodhi tree, the first thing he said, I have found profound, brilliant, peaceful, extremeless, uncompounded truth. But no matter who I tell, nobody is going to hear this. Therefore, I shall remain silent. That's what he said. And then, you know, like Indras and Brahmas, they came and they offered him, you know, Dharma Chakra, and supposedly they requested, and out of the compassion, then he taught. So all these teachings, expedient teachings, where he talks things like reincarnation, this is something you need to know. Always they say, always, especially Buddhist intellectuals, they don't and especially the so-called Buddhist intellectuals in the West, they always know, well, the Buddhist teachings on emptiness, it's kind of good. It's like really logical and it's really nice. But I don't know about Buddhist teachings on about reincarnation. They sort of laugh at this. This is where they don't understand the Buddhist teachings. Buddha never said there is a reincarnation ultimately, never. According to him, there is a reincarnation as much as there is a head on your neck. It's all on the illusory level. Buddha taught so many different things, but the main thing, the aim, is to understand the non-duality.
So whereas in Abrahamic religions, in conflicts between different sects of Christianity, the rivals would be sent to hell by their opponents, etc. In this case, the Buddhists just kind of put their opponents somewhat on the short bus. It's kind of, this is your mental aptitude. Nothing against you. Nothing, you know, the short bus will get you there. The short bus will get you there just as well. This is part of the long tradition of Eastern religions, of the battles between Eastern religions. So, for example, in the universal Buddhist case among all schools, it is written that when Buddha obtained enlightenment, all the Hindu gods came by and begged him to teach the Dharma. They realized that he is in fact above them and that they now have to bow down to him in order to receive his teachings finally. Alternatively, when Buddhism was dying out in India, the Hindus actually integrated the Buddha as a manifestation of Vishnu. You can find Hindu temples with statues of Buddha there. Except he is now the embodiment of a Hindu god. And that's actually how Mahatma Gandhi viewed Buddhism. He didn't view it as a separate religion. He thought that Buddha was a reformer of Hinduism.
The Big Show.
And that he belongs in the overall Hindu universe, whereas that's completely not true, because the Hindus believe in the soul, in the reincarnating soul that is guided, I believe, through devotion to these gods through the different caste systems and different realms of existence. Whereas in the case of the Buddha, he explicitly rejected the soul. You might be familiar with that old joke, why don't Buddhists play the blues? It's because they don't have a soul. So those religions are different, but the way that they approach each other, or the way that different sects of Buddhism approach each other, would be different from the more absolutist logic of Abrahamic faiths.
Namaskaram, Sadhguru. I just want to know the basic difference of the way of Shiva and the way of Buddha.
It's very easy to talk about Buddha's way because it's very logical. It's quite simple, actually. And it's a very long drawn-out process. Generally, the methods that Gautama gave to people were always a question of a few lifetimes. You can clearly see this today. The Buddhists are always talking about this, particularly the Tibetan Buddhists, who are the best-known Buddhists in the world today for whatever political reasons. They're always talking about a few lifetimes of work. So if you have that kind of patience, that you're willing to work for a few lifetimes, Gautama's ways are very efficient, very logical, scientific, step-by-step process that one can take, because this is a path of awareness. The significance of walking the path of awareness is there are milestones on the way which tell you you come 1 mile, 2 miles, 10 miles. It tells you where you are. That is the most important aspect. That is, without too much trust or devotion, you can still grow because you have a method to hang on to. You just keep doing it, keep doing it, keep doing it. It clearly shows you that you're progressing. But with Shiva, there is no such guarantee. And he doesn't fix milestones. You don't know whether you're going forward or backward. But you're going somewhere, that's all you know. It's like falling into your bottomless pit. That sounds terrifying. I want you to understand this. A bottomless pit is the safest place to fall into. A pit with a bottom is dangerous. A bottomless pit is absolutely safe. Your life is done. If you just jump into it, it's done. Simply you fall.
First of all of Hinduism is theistic, right? So Hindu Tantra is also theistic. In Sanskrit it is called Ishwarvad, belief in a god, a creator god, you know. Buddhism is non-theistic, un-Ishwarvad. There is no Ishwar, no creator god that created the world. If you have understood the principle of pratitya samutpada, interdependent origination, then you know that this sansara, I prefer to use the word sansara rather than to universe, because universe means only the physical world, you know. Sansara includes non-physical world as well, you know, is beginningless and endless. It is a flow of causes and conditions, you know, river of causes and conditions, continuously changing, you know. And that is the reason why Ishwar or God, capital G God, is meaningless in Buddhism. You know, the question arises, when did he create? The Bible says 4,000 years ago. but in Buddhism, that's meaningless, you know. When did he create? It was always there. The universe is beginningless, you know. So he didn't create the universe. He didn't create sansara, or he or she, whoever, you know, God is supposed to be. So it's Buddhism is non-theistic, and that already makes it a big difference, you know. Then it's very interesting. Human are human. We have the same psychology, you know. Depending on what kind of a view you have, you begin to experience that kind of thing, you know. So all theistic religious system, when they go down into deep meditation, seems to have the same kind of experience. I will explain in Hinduism. Hinduism, there are three levels of experience, you know. The first is called dasoham. Das means slave. Aham is close to the English word I am, right? So dasoham, you know, I am the slave. The god, or whatever deity is taken as god, like Krishna or Kali or whatever, I am the slave of that god, you know. So I take the mantra and the whatever, and then read, study, practice, meditate on that god, on that deity, that particular deity, over and over again, over and over again, over and over again. And it seems to be a common human mind psychology that all over theistic religious system, they seem to be having the same kind of experience. Gradually, the person begins to merge into that deity, you know, through his faith, devotion, and the mantra or whatever into the deity. And that is called soham. So means that, aham, I am. I am that. I am that particular deity. You know? And then if the person keeps on going deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper, he dissolves completely into the deity. He doesn't exist anymore. Only the deity exists. You know, and that is naham. Na means no, aham, no me. You know, these three steps are the steps of Hindu Tantra. You know, now Hinduism is a very complex system, so I'm generalizing it. There are forms of Hindu Tantra and Hinduism which are very dualistic. In that case, there is no way I become that. You know? But most of Hindu Tantra, Shaiva Tantra, and the female deity called Shakti is female deities, Tantra, they are all non-dualistic. And this is the process of experience in the non-dualistic systems. You know? Now, it's very interesting, the Sufi saint, Al-Mansur, said almost the same thing. You know, Haq is truth, means the truth. It is the name of Allah, right? And this is the word that has trickled down even into Nepali. And Haq means right in Nepali, my right. And Mansur said, Hu al-Haq, I am the slave of Allah. Then An al-Haq, I am Allah, the same as Allah. And then Haq, only Allah. It's exactly the same, you know. The only difference is in the Abrahamic religious system, this is considered as heretic, unfortunately. And Mansur was crucified for it, you know, put on the stake for it, you know. And he was a famous man, he was a great man. They called him to the court and they said, withdraw the statement and we'll leave you. And he said, how can I withdraw the truth? This is the truth. So then they had to put him in the stake, you know. And he was impaled. That's the English word, I think, you know, impaled. And but here in India, such people were idolized.
So it's important to understand that the word Hinayana doesn't really reflect the way that the vast majority of Tibetan Buddhists and Lamas actually look at Theravada today. It's just one of those old words used for classification that emerged out of the sectarian rumble and tumble of Buddhist India that no longer exists. Buddhism effectively died out in India, and this is the remnant of it. It was used in Tibet as a classification for different types of motivations, with the Hinayana motivation considered to be inferior, the motivation for personal liberation only, while disregarding all the mother sentient beings suffering in samsara around you. The word Hinayana has become a bit of the N-word in the Buddhist world, and in fact there was a Buddhist World Congress where it was officially sort of condemned, and people pledged not to use it, even though they do, because it's just in all the scriptures. They do use it, but it's not, and we're not talking about Theravada there.
Theravada tradition, usually, I think, unfortunately, there is some kind of impression, the wrong impression, as yesterday I mentioned, so-called Hinayana and Mahayana. And people, you see, have the feeling completely different. That's absolutely wrong. The Theravada teaching is the foundation of Buddha Dharma. Then, Bodhisattva-yana, sometimes you see called Mahayana. That's specialized about altruism. And then philosophical field, the further sort of discussion about shunyata. So all these so-called Mahayana sort of tradition is based foundation of Buddha Dharma, that is for Noble Truth and the 37 practice or these things, and particularly Vinaya is the foundation of Buddha Dharma. Buddha himself, you see, mentioned where Vinaya practice, there
Buddha feel
his presence. His presence.
His
presence.
So whether there is Buddhism or not is actually where monk community and the three practice, monsoon practice or the retreat, and these three practice there, Buddhism there. That no longer there, no longer Buddhism. So like that. So therefore, unless you know these things, then the people from Theravada country, they say, oh, Tibetan Mahayana. Almost something like non-Buddhist. Some Western authors also describe Tibetan Buddhism as Lamaism. As this morning I mentioned, unfortunately, in Tibetan community, Tibetan society, last several centuries, Tulgu become like social status. I'm highest. So almost like the social status.
No.
Absolutely wrong. He also, you see, a small Tulgu. He is not. But actual sense, he carries some teaching in his own monastery. He is actually Lama. And he also carries some teaching. So Lama. So hopefully I'm also little Lama carrying some teaching. So unfortunately, some people satisfy or contented with big name, Tulgu, and high throne. Knowledge zero. Experience zero. How can be a teacher like that? Nowadays, I'm quite bluntly telling people, and also to the Chinese, there are false lamas, false tulgu, now coming, seeking sex, seeking money. Absolutely wrong.
And it's also important to remember that Mahayana in no way invalidates all of those foundational teachings. It just invalidates those parts where the Buddha was talking to these guys who really were of limited ability, of limited capacity, just in those places. It's true that different teachings were then delivered to bodhisattvas who were way higher on the ladder to enlightenment. But certain foundational things like the monastic code, obviously the Four Noble Truths, without them the rest of the teachings wouldn't make sense. So they are in fact the foundational teachings. So these are the two vehicles, Hinayana, foundational vehicle, and Mahayana. And then the third one is Tantra, it is Vajrayana. Vajrayana is a subset of Mahayana, but in methods and in points of emphasis, it is significantly different from Mahayana. Therefore, it has its own category. But again, Vajrayana, Tantra, it is a subset of Mahayana. So let's review these vehicles. In the foundational vehicle, the Buddha introduced the problem and he introduced the solution. By definition, this vehicle is a bit dualistic. It's a sort of black and white, samsara, nirvana, bad and good. However, the idea of lacking an inherent self, of selflessness, when it came to us, was introduced there. And also dependent origination, the foundational Buddhist belief in cause and effect, has been introduced also in the foundational vehicle. And then the Mahayana vehicle calcifies, or maybe let me zeroes in, I guess, or points out emptiness, lack of inherent existence. So you wouldn't start your cycle of teachings as an enlightened being. You wouldn't start them with saying form is emptiness, emptiness is form. You first have to establish a type of a dualism, because that's the way most of us relate with the world. You don't begin your teachings with saying there is no samsara, there is no nirvana, everything is free of inherent existence, Gare Gare Paragare Parasamgari Bodhisoha. I'm sure that I'm mispronouncing it every time, but go beyond. Go beyond what? First, you have to establish something to go beyond from.
Gate, 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 para gate, para sangate, bodhisattva.
So therefore, the Mahayana vehicle is about openness of emptiness and also compassion, about combining these two together so that compassion powers your wisdom. And your wisdom is connected with a pure, open heart mind to obtain enlightenment for the benefit of all beings. So what is left there? What is left in Vajrayana? If non-duality was introduced in the Mahayana cycle of teachings, then the totality, the completion of non-duality, comes in Vajrayana, thinking about it as a pyramid without which no other part could exist. You can't have the Mahayana without the dualistic foundation. And then without the introduction of emptiness, you can't have Vajrayana. So what is Vajrayana? Well, remember those afflictive emotions that we talked about before, like anger and all of those things that seemingly bind us to samsara? Well, finally, in the Vajrayana, you can actually use them to obtain enlightenment. You can use these so-called negative emotions, so-called afflictive emotions, to obtain enlightenment, because they, of course, like everything else, are empty of inherent existence.
And perhaps it would have been misused by necromantic priests or something in some sort of strange cults.
There are a couple of ways you can look at Tantra. The first one is one I just outlined. It's the traditional one. The way Tantra is traditionally introduced is through the use of these seemingly negative emotions and transforming them into enlightening forces within you. The second way to look at it is practicing from the point of view of the result. We have been practicing from the point of view of the path, but what about practicing from the point of view of enlightenment itself? Now, this seems to make no sense until you remember that within the effect, there are the elements of the cause, of course, and within the cause, there are elements of the effect. The two are interconnected, and within you, you have Buddha nature, you have your pure, unmolested or unpolluted awareness, and you can practice utilizing that more directly, utilizing your Buddha nature.
Ultimately, all of you, all of us, all the sentient beings in the entire existence throughout the space are future Buddha. And everything that exists or manifests out there, including our own dwelling environment, they are ultimately the pure land, pure sacred manifestation. So ultimately, you don't have to do anything, I don't have to do anything, nobody have to do anything. Everything and everyone is perfect, ultimately, at all time and beyond time. Relatively, which is the relative of that very ultimate, then we are sentient beings who are dwelling and wandering in the countless universes that are outcome of our own karma, concept, and perception. This is a big dream, at times nightmare, at times wonderful dreams. Time itself is a dream. A dream itself is a dream. How we dream right now, because we don't know we are dreaming. That is because we don't know everything is perfect ultimately at all time. As a result of that, then moment by moment we separate ourself from our own manifestation. Physical body, mental facets, and outside universe and surroundings. That give birth to ignorance that it is. And out of the ignorance, the greed, hatred, jealousy, ego pride, so on and so forth. As a result of this, the illusion of those defilements manifest as we are right now.
In Vajrayana practice, what we special emphasize is you are Buddha right now and right here.
And finally, practice of Tantra involves the subtle body. What is the subtle body? My friends, the fuck if I know, because I never practiced Tantra and I know very little about it, frankly. But if you must know, the subtle body is, or maybe I am practicing it just in secret, pretending to be an imbecile, pretending to be a clown, using my skillful means to lure you into Buddhism. This whole channel has been an introduction to this very moment.
To this very moment.
Unfortunately, nobody's watching. Well, anyway, the subtle body is like an energy grid that expands from our mind into every body that we inhabit throughout our many lives. It's an energy grid that runs through us and has different energy clusters, different chakras. And you can get into that energy grid and work with it to obtain enlightenment.
The disciplined mind then becomes a powerful tool in its own right, enabling the practitioner to become aware of the subtle energies of the body, then master them through the breathing and physical postures known as yogas. Modern Western medicine has documented the mental powers of these meditation masters. One such practice, Tummo, was developed for generating body heat in the icy caves of Tibet. Yogis who have mastered Tummo are capable of immersing themselves in icy lakes and, 15 minutes later, producing visible steam rising from their robes.
I am here on a retreat with permission from His Holiness Chetsan Rinpoche. After many years retreat, I came to the conclusion that a human being's physical constitution in particular was a big impediment for serious practitioners. I came to realize that the only way to remove these impediments was to attain mastery over the five elements so that my practice did not have to be dependent upon sustenance and health. I read Milarepa's life history. It completely ravished away my mind. I strongly aspired to master the six yogas of Naropa, as well as the secret prana, nadi, and bindu, the three main components that are important in the practice of yoga. At any cost, I was determined to train myself to be able to master tummo or chandali. To do this, I found that Dharamsala was not conducive to the attainment of my aspirations. I needed a teacher who could pour down in me his experiential knowledge of such practices. I wanted the result of my efforts to create and leave an indelible imprint on my mind stream that I can forever carry forward. The most difficult thing to do is remain in single-pointed concentration. Bodily efforts, like doing hundreds of thousands of prostrations, and the efforts of speech, like recitation of mantras, are no problem. Controlling the mind is.
Indeed, the most profound evidence of the mind-altering effects of prolonged retreat are to be found in the oldest practitioners. Yet many of these elders have been imprisoned or killed in the half-century of Chinese occupation. Perhaps the oldest living Tibetan yogi is Druwang Rinpoche, possibly the most revered yogi alive today. Here, for the first time, he grants a filmed interview, a rare glimpse into the mind of a meditation master.
Now I have meditated for a very, very long time. It is very difficult for me to exactly reflect back and count the years that I have meditated. The reason for this is because although I do appear like a human person outwardly, my mental state is so different. Different in the sense that my focus on mundane things is not consistent. When one meditates, from the very day when one decides to go on solitary retreat, one has made a conscious decision to endure all kinds of losses, good clothing, good food, name, fame, and prestige. All these things one must be ready to forego and give up. We are rationed the barest minimum amount of water and roasted barley flour for our sustenance, so that we may be able to sit in a meditation posture. Only once in a week we would have the smallest possible amount of food for our sustenance. You have to persistently make a consistent effort and undergo all kinds of hardship. Without undergoing hardship, one would not be able to experience the mental state of all the glorious past masters. When I meditate, I can see all my former lives. I have been born in the realm of hell. I have been born as a hungry ghost. I have been born many times as animals. All these things become very, very clear when one is in meditation. I've gone through the three lower realms of existence many times. In my meditative absorption, I always go through the pardo or intermediate gap, which is to say, between death and rebirth. But there isn't a great deal of point going into this. When one understands this life and the life after as one, to such a person there's no need to go into these nitty-gritty things. When one's body is already dismantled in one's meditation, there's no question of death or discarding one's physical body.
Tantra is presented as the short path, the difficult path. It is short because you go directly to the point, you go directly to these so-called afflictive emotions, and you grab them in a sense and use them for your practice. You use them as the rockets, as the fuel for your practice. You try to mount that wild horse and ride into the sunset of awakening on this wild stallion. However, you might also be thrown off of it and have your ass kicked by it, because working with these emotions, of course, is dangerous. You're going into your subtle body, you're going deep into your energy grid, which is different than just meditating on the Four Noble Truths, you're doing something that could get you shocked and could have profound negative consequences. And this is precisely why, in order to practice Tantra, you need to receive teachings from a guru. You have to adopt somebody as your guru, as your guide into this very challenging and difficult practice.
And therefore, I'd like to offer these words and sentiments of praise toward Google for that and thank them for that. But other than that, I don't have any special requests to make.
Thank you.
Okay. Anything thank I can do for you, you tell me off stage.
Okay, probably. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, so we have some Dory questions, and so let's alternate live question then Dory question. Okay, yes, my friend, Shady.
Your Holiness, thank you for your presence.
Thank you.
On the topic of meditation, I have a couple questions. I'm a student of the six yogas of Naropa, and been learning about the practice of Tummo meditation.
Okay.
And so I wondered if you could talk about the benefits of Tummo meditation, and perhaps any advice for a Westerner wishing to practice Tummo, inner fire.
Wow.
It's a hot question.
Tummo golya jidang dinge mise di tholya tada.
Firstly, I haven't done any practice of Tummo for myself, so I can't explain in great detail about that practice. But what I would say in general is that there's different ways in Buddhism we approach taming our mind or calming our mind. One is in reliance on the prana, or the inner winds, and then one is by working with the mind itself. So working with the mind itself to tame our mind is the safe way to relate to our mind in the context of meditation. It takes a little bit more time. You need a little bit more patience in order to transform your mind that way. But if you stick with it, you can do it, and there's less danger. The six dharmas of Naropa, in particular the practice of Tummo, falls into the category of relying on the pranas, or inner winds, in order to transform the mind. And that's a more dangerous approach. You get to the desired result, it is said, in a faster way, but because you're going faster, it's also more dangerous at the same time. So greater caution needs to be applied when taking that approach. But if you have that proper caution, and if you regard that practice not just as being about inner heat or something like this, but as a method for further enhancing and establishing peace of mind and peace in our mind, then such practices can definitely be beneficial.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For aspiring yogis, events such as these imply control over the process of reincarnation. Even His Holiness the Dalai Lama has stated that if the Chinese communists are still governing Tibet at the time of his death, he will choose rebirth outside of Tibet. Controlling the process of one's own death and rebirth is the subject of some of the most fascinating stories surrounding Tibet's yogis. Lama Drupal Samten recalls vividly one such event in his early years as a student, the death of his own teacher, Khemgo Rinpoche.
This is my teacher, Khemgo Rinpoche. He invited all the students. He told he's going to pass away. No illness, nothing sign of death, nothing. He just normally get up, do his prayer, and he told his attendant to make a good tea. And then he make a tea over and over and until he's satisfied. And he says, all this prayer together. And when he get to the completion state, he says, this is the time for me to pass away. And just like a falling asleep, like a Buddha, you know, just he put his right hand under his cheeks and then lie down and look at each person. No, he's doing prayer for each person to benefit in the future. And he passed away.
Telling stories such as these, indeed revealing any technique, tradition, or experience to someone who has not completed yogic training, was once a violation of yogic vows to extreme secrecy. The reason was to maintain the purity of the teachings. The fear was that, taken out of context, exotic forms of yoga and meditation might degenerate into ego-centered showmanship. And in the eyes of the elders, the opening up that is taking place now is seen as a significant risk. When His Eminence Druong Rinpoche was asked about the cutting of his hair, a practice known to signify that a yogi is preparing to die, he displayed the stubborn elusiveness of a yogi under strict vow.
There are many reasons why a person in retreat would grow hair. Let me think about it. Yeah, there are many reasons why one would grow one's hair long. Let's just forget about it, shall we? A good number of things happened to me. It will just boil down to misleading people. Forget it. You know, I just cut it because I am old, and the hair was really hefty and weighing me down. That's why I chopped it off. I have pledged not to mislead people. Now, if I told you a whole lot of tall tales, that will amount to misleading the audience. I have absolutely nothing whatsoever, and I have nothing to tell you. This is the first time I have been asked to tell about these things. We are not supposed to reveal the ins and outs of what goes on inside a meditation cave. If we do, then there will be consequences. The past masters, including Tilopa, have categorically said there was never an instance where he revealed the secrets of meditation. We who follow in their footsteps must do the same.
Although it is known that Druong Rinpoche did cut his hair in preparation for death, His Holiness the Dalai Lama asked him to live a little longer to help pass on and preserve Tibetan teachings. It is said that His Eminence agreed to do so.
One example of a tantric practice is chod. I'm not sure how to pronounce it correctly. It was introduced by a female tantric practitioner, Machik Lodron. I believe that's how her name is pronounced. Once again, I'm just not sure, my friends. This practice was introduced around 1,000 years ago. What it involves is going to like a funeral pyre or some sort of a place where recently perhaps a horrible accident has happened and people have died, some equivalent of a cemetery situation. And you would have a human thigh bone as a kind of a flute, like a musical instrument, I'm not sure what you would call it, and you would have the drums. And going through this ritual at night, you would summon the demons, the evil spirits, and you would offer your flesh to them for a tantric feast. You would go through these summonations, through these rituals, fully visualizing yourself with a tender, open heart, calling out to them to consume your flesh. And I mean, you would need to go through the process of making this as real as possible. And of course, people have traditionally, who performed this practice, many of them believed in actual local spirits that would in fact respond to this tantric feast of your body. And then you would describe in a fashion of them consuming your flesh. So this ritual seemed to not relate at all to Buddhism, except that it does. Because by doing this, you're releasing your ego clinging, cutting through the delusion of the self, going through the emptiness of inherent existence, because of course, these demons don't have any inherent existence. So you would cycle through this, working as hard as you can to make it as real as possible, and then cycling through the emptiness of the whole experience finally, and the absurdity of the ego clinging. So you can see how this practice done incorrectly without the directions of a teacher could literally make you insane. Something like that could make you utterly insane if you were committed to it and yet didn't have the subtle understanding and the subtle way of doing it.
So when you take an empowerment from a person, it should be from an enlightened lineage. And somebody who has received those empowerments and has practiced those. Not somebody who just reads it out of a book. Tantra books, texts, and the empowerment of Tantra is considered so powerful that, let's say, Joe can read it. So he gives you guys all the empowerment and everything, and you practice the mantras, you will attain siddhi, you know, powers to do things and those kind of things, you know. But both Joe and you will go to hell after death. So that is that powerful. So if you take it from an enlightened lineage master, authentic master, then it's very powerful in transforming yourself. You know? And that's very important to understand. You don't take this thing like new age types, you know. You don't read it out of the YouTube and decide you've received the empowerment and practice on your own or something like that. Because these are very, very powerful practices, like sandali, tummo. You know, I met a Japanese, I knew him. He knew Tibetan, and so he took the Tibetan books back to Japan and read them and practiced the tummo practice. And the heat started arising, and finally his entire lower belly split open. And then he ran to the hospital, and the doctors were like, "Son, what did you do? Did you cut yourself? You know, like harakiri or something?" No. And he couldn't explain to them what he did, you know. So he said, "Just stitch me up, please. Just stitch me up, you know." And he had this stitched mark right through all this, you know. So these practices are very powerful. If you don't take it from a correct, authentic master with the authentic instructions and so on, they are very powerful. And as they say, Vajrayana is like a bamboo with a snake inside. There are only two ways the snake goes, either straight up or straight down. So that's Vajrayana. It's kind of both of them. One is that there's an energy blessing, what is called adhisthana in Sanskrit, jinlap in Tibetan, is carried through to the lineage. So the Vajrayana process is swift and fast because of those blessings. It does not mean that it's going to happen only by those blessings. You have to make your effort too, right? But it's quicker and faster. But the other point which you said is like there are minute, very fine instructions that are carried down through the centuries, you know? And those are really related to experiential things. So an unbroken lineage has all the necessary instructions, and the person has experienced them too. You know, so he can give those instructions. Now, if you don't have those instructions, then again, it's the practices are kind of vague, you know, and then everybody can have his own kind of experience and those kind of thing. It has to go towards a certain direction, correct direction. For example, let me give an example. When do you meditate? Actually, any kind of meditate, but more powerfully if you do meditations on tantric practices, you know, tantra practices, the three things arise: clarity, bliss, and non-thought. You know, now many systems around the world take one of these as the enlightened state. When there is no thought complete, then they think that's non-conceptual, you know, and that is the enlightened state. Some, when there is extreme clarity of awareness, just remaining by itself, they think that is the enlightened state. Some people think bliss arising, that is the purpose of meditation, bliss, that's most important. But in the instructions, you are required, you are told, if you have a correct master, not to cling to any of them, because none of them are enlightenment. You know, they contribute to enlightenment, but none of them are enlightenment per se. You know, now these kind of things, if you don't have those instructions, then you can cling to clarity, you can cling to non-thought, you can cling to bliss, and then go on. And there are many, many, many people in other traditions who cling to bliss. They have powerful, blissful experiences, and they think that is the enlightened state. You know, and they believe that if you are enlightened, you must be blissful, almost, or maybe blissed out, completely blissed out continuously, you know. So these kind of minute things, and then in the practice of tummo, for example, they are very, very minute instructions that are important. Because otherwise, as I said, it can be dangerous, like the Japanese who had his lower belly split open. But if you have the correct instruction, the lower belly won't split open. Well, so it's both. The lineage blessing and the instructions are intact. And one of the reasons why in Hinduism there's so much mix up right now is that the lineages are gone. So the lineage blessing and also the lineage instructions are dead. So each master is his own master. He just creates his own interpretations of the thing, gives his own instructions and so on. But there is a saying in Buddhism, no matter how great the master is, if he contradicts the Buddha's teaching, he's not a Buddhist master. No matter how Vajrayana or Zen or so on, they don't contradict the Buddha's teaching. They are teaching the Buddha's teaching. Maybe the wordings are different, sometimes even contradictory, but they're teaching the Buddha's teaching. And if it is not the Buddha's teaching, if it is against the Buddha's teaching, it contradicts the Buddha's teaching, then that is not Buddhism. Then it can't be Vajrayana or Zen or anything. So in Zen, the use of words are done differently. So sometimes they seem to say, kill the Buddha, but they don't really mean kill the Buddha. Kill the Buddha means your concept of Buddha, your concept of Buddha, kill that, because that is what is hindering you from realizing Buddha. The wordings can be misinterpreted very easily, but if you are with a genuine Zen master, then you are guided properly, The same way in Vajrayana also.
A widespread tantric practice is the practice with a yidam, or a meditation deity. These are the wrathful or strange-looking images you might associate with Tibetan Buddhism. A meditation deity is a focus of your meditation. It is a hero of your meditation that represents different aspects of the so-called afflictive emotions that you're working with to overcome, that they actually embody for you to overcome. So in a yidam practice, you would choose one of these deities, and then during a prolonged meditation, you would literally visualize them and visualize yourself as being them with all of their qualities and aspects. And then at the end of this practice, you would dissolve them into your mind, effectively dissolving them into emptiness. So these visualization practices are extremely specific, and they give an outline of all the aspects and physical attributes of these yidams. So I will in this case describe to you, or actually read to you, a description of one yidam from Wikipedia. Now, you have been warned that this is a horrible introduction to Tibetan Buddhism, so I was too lazy to find a description, a fancy description that's not in Wikipedia, but the yidam I will be describing is going to be Vajrayogini. Vajrayogini is a 16-year-old female with the third eye. Each aspect of Vajrayogini's form and mandala is designed to convey a spiritual meaning. For example, her brilliant red-colored body symbolizes the blazing of her tummo. Tummo is inner heat. Yogis who practice this can actually generate inner heat, increase their body heat for prolonged periods of time, and they use this to spend time in meditation and caves. This has been scientifically documented. They can, in fact, increase their body heat.
For years, Dr. Herbert Benson of the Harvard Medical School has been conducting experiments on Buddhist monks from Tibetan monasteries to assess the effects of meditation on the body's metabolism. His research has provided a remarkable insight into the ways the mind can alter the functioning of the body.
What we found with respect to their oxygen consumption, in simple meditation, they decrease their metabolism upwards of 64%. And this was the largest decrease in oxygen consumption that was ever recorded in experiments by a simple restful procedure.
Carefully monitoring a form of Dzogchen meditation known as Tummo, the yoga of inner heat, Benson came up with even more intriguing results.
What we found initially in Tumo was that monks were able to increase their skin temperature in environments of 50 to 60 degrees Fahrenheit.
But that was just the beginning.
Well, what we found in these monks in very cold environments of 40 degrees Fahrenheit, wrapping themselves in wet sheets, these monks astoundingly could increase their temperature enough to get the sheets steaming and dry the sheets. You and I would go into uncontrollable shivering and perhaps even die of too low blood pressure. They were quite comfortable there simply by performing their Tumo meditational heat yoga.
When asked how they do it, the monks describe relaxing, focusing on their breathing. They picture air coming in and out as a kind of energy. They visualize it as a flame, a fire coursing through the chest.
I'm a student of the six yogas of Naropa, and been learning about the practice of Tumo meditation.
Okay.
However, the inner effects of this body heat are more important than the outer manifestation of increasing your body temperature and holding on to it through meditation. The blazing of her Tumo, or inner fire of spiritual transformation, as well as life force, blood of birth and menstrual blood. So all of these things explain why her color is red. Her single face symbolizes that she has realized that all phenomena are of one nature and emptiness. Her two arms symbolize her realization of the two truths. Her three eyes symbolize her ability to see the past, present, and future. She looks upward toward the pure Dakini land, demonstrating her attainment of outer and inner pure Dakini land, and indicates that she leads her followers to these attainments. The curved Driguk knife in her right hand shows her power to cut the continuum of the delusions and obstacles of her followers and of all living beings. Drinking the blood from her capilla in her left hand symbolizes her experience of clear light of bliss. So when you see these smiling Tibetan monks, including all of them, this is what's going on in their inner life. It's quite rich and interesting. You could say, if you want to be a little bit sectarian, much more interesting than that of Theravadan monks. This is what's going on. Working with those things could make being a monk or a yogi very, very exciting, because visualizing yourself as this 16-year-old girl is just the beginning of your potential tantric adventures.
Here's another thing. Some of you have heard of Vajrayogini practice, yes? Yes or no? Okay. She's a power babe, okay? But men and women practice this. It doesn't have to just be women. Vajrayogini.
And I mean, this stuff is really amazing. You have to imagine what it would be like to actually have the meditative concentration to really visualize her and then experience it, as experience yourself as being her with these qualities, and then dissolve the whole thing. If you really have a certain ability, a high ability to dedicate yourself to developing the discipline of visualization, I mean, these experiences would be quite amazing and rich, especially if you're alone in a cave for 3 years, which is the standard time frame of a serious retreat, 3 years, 3 months, and 3 days.
Thank you.
Why would I do that? Is the grass really greener on the other side? From the perspective of regular sex versus tantric sex, I gotta tell you, the grass is pretty green.